T-minus 10.
Go for launch. And we are igniting the engines. And we're clear of the tower.
Copy, 1 Bravo.
That 1 Bravo indicator are different abort modes that are called that allow the ground teams and the crew to track about the position of the Falcon 9 and the Dragon as they make their way up the eastern seaboard. In the event of an abort, these different abort modes will indicate about the position where Dragon would land, as well as indicate what series of maneuvers Dragon would indicate. But so far, we're hearing good calls on the performance of the Falcon 9 on its ride uphill. 1 minute, 53 seconds into flight.
We're about 30 seconds away from main engine cutoff, which will be followed quickly by stage separation and second engine start, which is the ignition of that MVAC engine on the second stage. Now about 10 seconds away from main engine cutoff.
And there we have it, a spectacular nighttime launch there. Leroy, it's amazing how, no matter how many times you see it, it still kind of, you know, takes your breath away when these launches take place at night.
Oh, yes. Very spectacular night launches. Very different from a day launch. You can see the vehicle for a lot longer because of you can see the engines burning. So very different experience. And here we've seen the first stage is separated successfully. Second stage is ignited. And so everything is looking great so far.
And just talk about the vehicle that's getting them to the ISS. We're looking at the Falcon 9 rocket, which is topped with an autonomously operated Crew Dragon capsule. That's called Endeavour. So while there are actual astronauts on board, you know, this capsule, the Endeavour, they're actually not doing a whole lot right now?
That's right, especially during the launch phase. They're in automatic mode, and so they're monitoring all the systems, and there's actually, you know, very little control the crew has right now. If they had to abort, if something went wrong and they had to separate and come back, they could initiate that manually, or it could also be initiated automatically in case of a sensor that detects the anomaly. But right now, they're just monitoring all the systems and making sure everything is fine. And so far, it looks like everything is right on the money.
And these guys will be at the International Space Station when the Boeing crew flight test arrives. That's going to be in April. This is the first, the last step on the way for Boeing to get their Starliner certified for space travel?
That's right. So this upcoming scheduled mission for the Starliner will be the first one to carry astronauts. So this is a big one for Boeing. And so Starliner, if everything goes well, will dock to the station in April, and that'll be another big milestone.
Yeah. In the meantime, while they're waiting for the Starliner to turn up, these guys are going to carry out, 200 different experiments whilst up there? I mean, we hear about these experiments all the time, but are they, are they worth, are they any value, or are they kind of busy work?
Oh, no, no. These are definitely of high value. We concentrate mostly on life science experiments because it turns out that being in the space environment for a long period of time is actually pretty challenging for the human body, pretty challenging for health. And so we do these different biomedical experiments to help to validate and develop these what we call biomedical countermeasures, which we have to figure out before we start sending crews to places like Mars. And so they'll be doing mostly biomedical experiments, but you can expect also to see material science experiments and some other fundamental physics experiments. So they'll be doing a whole gamut of different kinds of research initiatives.
Leroy Chow, thanks so much for being with us. We appreciate your time, your experience. Good to have you with us for the journey.
Oh, my pleasure. Thank you.
Take care.